The annual Catholic Appeal. 60 years of changing lives in Western Massachusetts. Sharing, teaching, reaching. Respecting the dignity of life at all ages. Our Catholic mission calls us to be Christ in our world right now. Please donate to the annual Catholic Appeal today and help us put faith in action.
Good morning, my friends, and welcome to the Chalice of Salvation, coming to you on this last day of March from our Studio Chapel of the Holy Spirit, located here at St. Michael's Cathedral in Springfield. I'm your Chalice host, Passionist Brother Terence Scanlon. A new day has dawned in each reading today. The Israelites have finally reached the Promised Land and can celebrate the Passover. In our second reading, St. Paul tells us that in Christ we are all a new creation. And in our gospel account, the prodigal son is welcomed home as someone who has been dead and is now alive. As we listen to the readings today, let us imagine we are there as each new day dawns. And to celebrate this fourth Sunday of Lent, it's my pleasure to welcome Father Mark Mingle, chaplain to St. Michael's Academy, as our Mass presider. We welcome to our chapel the members from St. Michael's Academy who will make up our congregation and participate as our readers, servers, and gift presenters. Students from St. Michael's Academy will also be our music ministers this morning. We extend our welcome to the parents, teachers, and all who nurture their education. Marie Renaud from our Chalice Ministry will offer the prayers of the faithful. Our Mass intention this day is offered in loving memory of Vincent E. Gatta on this, his fifth anniversary of his death, and this is requested by his family. We also offer our heartfelt good wishes to all who are celebrating those special birthdays or anniversaries today and throughout the coming week. We remember this day and pray for those who are ill or homebound. To all who are watching this Chalice Mass from your hospital rooms or nursing homes, please know that you're always in our thoughts and prayers. We pray for you and all those special people who attend and care for your needs. We include, as always, the names that you, our viewing community, have sent into us for today's books of remembrance. We remember especially today two former co-workers here in our diocese. Mark D. Heck, Jr., our former Catholic Communications co-worker on this, his 10th anniversary, and David DeRosiers, who gave years of service to the diocese and who recently passed away last week. We remember both fondly in our prayers this day, and we pray that all our departed loved ones are in God's loving embrace. Following our Mass, we'll switch our liturgical seasons as we share a profile of one very talented St. Michael's Academy student who depicted of the manger scene brought him national attention. It's right after the Mass, asking you to please stay tuned. We now join the students from St. Michael's Academy in our opening hymn of gathering as we welcome our Mass presider, Father Mark Mingle, and together celebrate the fourth Sunday of Lent.
Take the victory. Good morning. And together we begin our Lenten journey, we continue our Lenten journey praising our God together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May the grace and the peace and the love of God be with you always. Before we listen to God's word and scripture and participate together in the Eucharist, we just take a moment to place ourselves in God's presence. We thank God for the many graces and blessings that God has bestowed upon us. As always, we ask for God's blessing on us and those we love. And for the faults and failings of this past week, we ask pardon of God as we say, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us. May God forgive us our sins and bring each of us to everlasting life. Amen. And let us pray. O God, who through your word reconcile the human race to yourself in a wonderful way, grant, we pray, that with prompt devotion and eager faith, the Christian people may hasten towards the solemn celebrations to come. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Joshua. The Lord said to Joshua, "Today I have removed the reproach of Egypt from you." While the Israelites were encamped at Gilgal on the plains of Jericho, they celebrated the Passover on the evening of the 14th of the month. On the day after the Passover, they ate of the produce of the land in the form of unleavened cakes and parched grain. On that same day after the Passover, on which they ate of the produce of the land, the manna ceased. No longer was there manna for the Israelites, who that year ate of the yield of the land of Canaan. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall be ever in my mouth. Let my soul glory the Lord. The lowly will hear me and be glad.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
Glorify the Lord with me. Let us together extol his name. I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and delivered me from all my fears.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
Look to him that you may be radiant with joy, and your faces may not blush with shame. When the poor one called out, the Lord heard, and from all his distress he saved him.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, whoever is in Christ is a new creation. The old things have passed away. Behold, new things have come. And all this is from God, who has reconciled us to give himself through Christ and given us the ministry of reconciliation. Namely, God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. so we are ambassadors for Christ, as if God were appealing through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin, who did not know sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And your
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Tax collectors and sinners were drawing near to listen to Jesus, but the Pharisees and the scribes began to complain, saying, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." So to them, Jesus addressed this parable. A man had two sons, and the younger son said to the father, "Father, give me a share of your estate that should come to me." So the father divided the property between them. After a few days, the younger son collected all his belongings and set off to a distant country where he squandered his inheritance on a life of dissipation. When he had freely spent everything, a severe famine struck that country, and he found himself in dire need. So he hired himself out to one of the local citizens who sent him to his farm to attend the swine. And he longed to fill himself of the pods of which the swine fed, but no one gave him any. Coming to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired workers have more than enough food to eat? And here I am, dying of hunger. I shall get up and go to my father, and I shall say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer deserve to be called your son. Treat me as you would treat one of your hired workers.' So he got up and went back to his father. While he was still a long way off, his father caught sight of him and was filled with compassion. He ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. His son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son.' But his father ordered his servants, 'Quickly, bring the finest robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Take the fattened calf and slaughter it. Then let us celebrate with a feast. Because this son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found.' Then the celebration began. Now the older son had been out in the field, and on his way back, as he neared the house, he heard the sound of music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked what this might mean. The servant said to him, 'Your brother has returned, and your father has slaughtered the fattened calf, because he has him safe back again.' He became angry, and when he refused to enter the house, his father came out and pleaded with him. He said to his father in reply, 'Look, all these years I served you, and not once did I disobey your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat to feed on with my friends. But when your son returns, who swallowed up your property with prostitutes, for him you slaughter the fattened calf.' He said to him, 'My son, you are always here with me. Everything I have is yours. But now we must celebrate and rejoice, because your brother was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
Please be seated for just a moment. I'm sure you'll agree with me, today's gospel is probably one of the best known stories in all of the Bible. Just about everyone, every Christian for sure, is familiar with the story in the parable of the prodigal son. I think what's important to realize, though, is the story begins with the scribes and the Pharisees complaining that Jesus was associating with and he was friendly with sinners and tax collectors. So as a response to their complaints, Jesus directs this parable to them. So this parable is directed to the scribes and the Pharisees. As the story unfolds, it becomes evident that given the historical context, that Jesus intended both the scribes and the Pharisees on one hand, and the tax collectors and sinners on the other, to see themselves as one of the two sons in the story. The scribes and the Pharisees are the loyal and faithful older son, while the tax collectors and the sinners are the younger son, who squandered his father's and his money and his inheritance. And as we heard, at the heart of the father's compassion and forgiveness for the lost son was the son's sincere sorrow and repentance for the sins he had committed and for the lifestyle he chose to live. And as we heard in the parable, it was nearly impossible for the loyal and faithful son to show the same mercy and forgiveness as the father toward his repentant brother. Do you and I act like the older son at times? For many of the religious leaders of Jesus' day, the concept or the idea of the God of Israel unconditionally accepting and embracing repentant tax collectors and sinners, and even Gentiles who were non-Jews, this was impossible for them to accept. It was incongruent with the notion that they had of God and with their understanding of the Torah, which was the Jewish law, and of the preaching of the prophets. To their idea, God rewarded those who were good, but punished those who were evil, were sinners. And it's important to remember and understand that the Pharisees of Jesus' day, these were good and sincere people. In fact, most scripture scholars believe that Jesus, who was a practicing and an observant Jew, was most likely a member of the Pharisee party, or at least one of their followers. The Pharisees prayed and fasted much more than the law required them to do. They set up synagogues throughout the country of Israel so that those who could not travel the great distance to the temple in Jerusalem would have a place to worship in their own neighborhoods. They gave generously to the poor. In their minds, the Pharisees were the epitome of what a good Jewish person should be, just as the older son in the parable believed himself to be the perfect son that his father wanted. The Pharisees, for the most part, were truly good people. However, their piety and their religious observances filled them with pride. They became a legend in their own minds. It gave them a sense of entitlement and a sense of superiority. It made them judgmental and condescending. They forgot that they too were sinners and were forgiven because of God's goodness and mercy. And because of their attitude, they were unable to forgive and show mercy and compassion to other people. They were the self-satisfied and the ungrateful and unforgiving son in the parable who would miss out on all the fun and all the celebrations because he could not share his father's joy that his lost son had finally returned home. The historical Jesus addressed this parable to the scribes and Pharisees, but it's also addressed to you and I, to us. We are all sinners. We all have faults and failings. We are all in need of forgiveness. And like the father in the parable, the God of love and mercy is always waiting for our return. Like the younger son, all we have to do is ask for forgiveness. And unlike the angry and the self-righteous son, in gratitude for God's mercy, you and I have to share God's mercy with other people. In other words, we have to forgive those who have offended us. So as we reach the halfway point of our Lenten journey, today's scripture readings challenge us to ask ourselves if our Lenten observances are making us more loving and more forgiving. Do we have more patience and compassion for others? Do we see Christ in all the people that we meet, especially those who maybe are different than we are, who maybe rub us the wrong way, or those we have a hard time getting along with? Today's readings remind us that our God is loving and merciful. And Lent is the time when we recognize our faults and failings and, with God's help, try to do better so that when we come to Easter Sunday and celebrate the resurrection, we may have hearts and minds renewed.
And now together, let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He will ascend to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, and who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead in the life of the world to come. Amen. Like the father of the prodigal son, God is always ready to welcome us with open arms and give us more than we deserve, so that we may have the confidence to voice our needs and the needs of our community.
Our response will be, Lord, hear us. We pray that those who lead us in faith and service in our church, Pope Francis, Bishop Rosansky, pastors and school leaders, continue to be guided by the Spirit. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
That our diocesan community may always be a welcoming place for those who have been separated from the church. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all in our country who are treated as outsiders, for the poor and poorly educated, refugees and the imprisoned, those struggling with mental illness or physical disabilities, and for those working on their behalf, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
For teachers, administrators, and staff and students in our Catholic schools, as they challenge and encourage the future of the children in their care, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
We pray for the benefactors and board members of our Catholic schools and parents who generously offer their time, talent, and treasure. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
We especially remember Vincent E. Gatta and the names that you, our chalice viewing community, have sent in to us for today's Book of Remembrance. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
Thank you.
Now let us pray together the closing prayer for the annual Catholic Appeal. God our Father, you are the giver of all gifts. We thank you for the gift of faith and the blessings we receive out of your love for us. Open our eyes and hearts, see the needs of our brothers and sisters. Inspire us in words and actions to comfort those who labor and who are burdened. Strengthen us to put our faith into action and reach out to others as Jesus taught us. May our faithful stewardship bear witness, love, and mercy of Jesus Christ. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Good job, John. And now let us pray together that our sacrifices may be acceptable to God, our all-loving Father. May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hand to the praise and the glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church. We place before you with joy these offerings, which bring eternal remedy, O God, praying that we may both faithfully revere them and present them to you as is fitting, for the salvation of all the world, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It
is truly right and just. It is our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you will that our self-denial should give you thanks. It should humble our sinful pride, contribute to the feeding of the poor, and so help us imitate you in your kindness. And so we glorify you with countless angels and saints, as with one voice of praise we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord. You are the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." And in song, we proclaim the great mystery of our faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and the blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and with Mitchell, our Bishop, and with all who minister to your people. Remember also our brothers and our sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. At this point in the Eucharistic prayer, we just take a moment to remember and pray for our departed relatives and friends. As always, we commend them to God and God's love and mercy. And we pray for all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray. Once again, we just take a moment to pray in silence, but this time we pray for one another. We all have people in our life who we want God to watch over and care for and protect. We place those people in God's hands at this time. So that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her spouse, and with the blessed apostles, and all the saints, especially Saint Michael, who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. For it is through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by his divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. And Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, and my peace I give you." As always, we ask that you look not on our sins, but rather on our faith and the faith of your church, and graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. And may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of our peace and friendship and love. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
And let us pray. Look upon those who call to you, O Lord, and sustain the weak. Give life by your unfailing light to those who walk in the shadow of death, and bring those rescued by your mercy from every evil to reach the highest good. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. First of all, I'd like to give a big shout out and a thank you to all the students and the teachers of St. Michael's Academy for the great job they did in reading and serving and singing. Great job, thank you. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless and watch over each of you and bless your families and homes. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our Eucharistic celebration is ended. Let's go in peace to love and serve God and one another. Thanks be to God.
Catholic Appeal. 60 years of changing lives in Western Massachusetts. Sharing, teaching, reaching. Respecting the dignity of life at all ages. Our Catholic mission calls us to be Christ in our world right now. Please donate to the annual Catholic Appeal today and help us put faith in action.
Come to Providence Place, owned by the Sisters of Providence, for retirees looking for an ideal rental setting to continue their active, independent lifestyles. We offer bright 1 and 2 bedroom apartments, a magnificent chapel with daily mass, restaurant-style dining, wellness and entertainment programs, all with a friendly community spirit on beautiful grounds. Call for a tour, 413-534-9700.
Our family is made up of every race. We are young and old, rich and poor, men and women, sinners and saints. Our family has spanned the centuries and the globe. With God's grace, we started hospitals to care for the sick. We establish orphanages and help the poor. We are the largest charitable organization on the planet, bringing relief and comfort to those in need. We educate more children than any other scholarly or religious institution. We developed the scientific method and laws of evidence. We founded the college system. We defend the dignity of all human life and uphold marriage and family. Cities were named after our revered saints who navigated a sacred path before us. Guided by the Holy Spirit, we compiled the Bible. We are transformed by sacred scripture and sacred tradition, which have consistently guided us for 2,000 years. We are the Catholic Church. With over 1 billion in our family, sharing in the sacraments and fullness of the Christian faith, for centuries we have prayed for you and our world, every hour of every day, whenever we celebrate the Mass. Jesus himself laid the foundation for our faith when he said to Peter, the first pope, "You are rock, and upon this rock I will build my church." For over 2,000 years, we've had an unbroken line of shepherds, guiding the Catholic Church with love and truth in a confused and hurting world. And in this world filled with chaos, hardship, and pain, it's comforting to know that some things remain consistent, true, and strong, our Catholic faith, and the eternal love that God has for all creation. If you've been away from the Catholic Church, we invite you to take another look. Visit CatholicsComeHome.org today. Ours is one family, united in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We are Catholic. Welcome home.
Travel with Catholic Communications in August 2020 for the Pilgrimage of the Decade as we experience the Oberammergau Passion Play. Join Springfield Bishop Mitchell Rosansky and Father Gary Daly for the spiritual journey to Germany and the village of Oberammergau. Since 1634, this famous play has been performed every 10 years in this quaint Alpine village. Our 10-day pilgrimage will begin in Brussels, Belgium, and continue through Cologne, Heidelberg, Oberammergau, and Munich, Germany. With daily breakfast and dinners included, pilgrims will enjoy daily Mass in many of Germany's brilliant cathedrals and churches, a cruise on the Rhine River, a tour of Cologne's cathedral treasury containing the staff of St. Peter, and a visit to Munich's famous Glockenspiel. Book this incredible opportunity now for $5,439. For more information, go to iobserve.org.
St. Michael's Academy, where a dynamic curriculum meets enriched learning. Where morals are instilled and confidence is boosted. Where lasting relationships are nurtured. And safety is priority. St. Michael's Academy.
It's a tradition almost as old as Christianity itself, telling the story of salvation through art. An 11-year-old student from St. Michael's Academy has continued this tradition with his prize-winning poster. Rebecca Drake has our story.
It's one of the most beloved images in all of Christian art, the Nativity of Jesus Christ. And the 2,000-year-old story of the birth of the Savior was the subject of a prize-winning poster designed by Joseph Langoni, a sixth grader at St. Michael's Academy in Springfield.
I just grabbed my chalk pastels and some of my markers and did a doodle of an Advent wreath we had made out of sand. So we turned it in, and I did win the first competition. And then 2 months later, they announced that I won the state version. So, and then they announced it was nationals.
Joseph's poster was part of last year's Keep Christ in Christmas contest, sponsored by his parish's Knights of Columbus Council. The council's grand knight, Frank Grimaldi, said the winning poster captures the true spirit of the season.
It is truly about the birth of Jesus. Mary is holding Jesus with the background set as it could have been back in the day. And It was such a touching piece. We knew it was special from the moment we saw it.
Joseph's art teacher, Amanda Alves, didn't know Joseph had entered the poster contest, but she wasn't surprised that he won.
He does have a very good control of the media and the subject. It's beautiful. It's very singular. It's not something you would normally see in a nativity scene.
For his part, the young artist credits his teacher with inspiring his work.
I love Mrs. Alves. She's the best. One of the best. She taught me how to use pastel, which I used for that. And we've had art class with her every Wednesday. And I do like all my subjects too, but I always like coming here because I feel it's a nice, safe, calm place where I can be myself.
And in the art room at St. Michael's Academy, Alves says, she is able to help students experience their faith in a deeper way.
It stays with them. And as their art teacher here at St. Michael's, I want to make sure that it's not just about the color and the line, the shape and the pattern, that it's about Jesus and Mary and God and this community and our friends here and our teachers here. And it's felt in every building, in every space in this school, for sure, that faith brings us all together.
In addition to the support of his school, Joseph says that the faith in his art and the faith in his heart have been formed here at Mount Carmel Church by his parish and by his parents. Dad Joseph and Mom Kristen Langoni have made faith a priority for young Joseph and his siblings, Stefania, Jude, and baby Vincent.
We ensure that the kids get to Mass every Sunday. They attend St. Michael's Academy, so they're getting a Catholic education, which is something that we're very committed to in spite of the sacrifice that entails financially. And we make sure that the kids pray. We talk about our faith.
Hopefully it helps them to be kind people. and hopefully it helps them to follow the right path and pursue their dreams and begin families of their own and continue the faith.
The focus on faith has clearly made an impression on their eldest son, according to the family's pastor, who sees a reflection of the artist's own character in his Christmas poster.
In that poster, I think he sees Jesus as a gift to a world that's waiting. It shows the desert, you know, and it's like the world is waiting. And you see all of the characters, the camels and the wise men and everyone waiting for this new birth, this new child. And for Joseph, I think it describes his kindness and his gentleness, his goodness, you know.
Joseph, who has entered the poster contest again this year, says it's important for all Catholics to keep Christ in Christmas.
Well, first of all, Christ is our Savior. God sent him to tell us about our sins and to save us from them. It's also important because that's our Savior's birth. We should always honor him in whatever we do.
And while the focus at Christmas is often on material presents, Joseph's parents believe the best gift has already been unwrapped.
And my children are no stranger to the reality that my wife and I talk about all the time, that the faith is the greatest gift that we have given them. And my prayer is that when I'm long gone and hopefully at home with the Lord, that they're still very strong in their resolve to believe and practice.
And as young Joseph continues to practice his art and his faith, he encourages all children to spend time with the Savior on the day of his birth.
We'll definitely go to church at about 4 o'clock for Christmas Eve. I'm going to be starting this year by serving midnight mass. And go to church anytime possible on Christmas Day, because that's one of the most important masses besides Easter and the Triduum.
Keeping Christ in Christmas, a reminder that the Holy Family is our family on Christmas and every day.
Thanks, Rebecca. In every one of our Catholic schools, you will find talented students like Joseph, the proud product of dedicated parents and a faith-inspired education. Our thanks to Father Mark Mingle for celebrating the fourth Sunday of Lent for us, and for his reflection on today's readings, and for sharing his priestly minister as chaplain to St. Michael's Academy and Pope Francis Prep School. Thanks to all who joined us from St. Michael's Academy for your presence with us and for sharing your gifts of music. Thanks as well to Principal Ann Dugal and staff for helping prepare this visit. Catholic schools benefit by your donation to the annual Catholic Appeal, asking you to please continue to support the annual Catholic Appeal going now throughout our diocesan communities. Please make your donation at diospringfield.org. Today again, that's diospringfield.org. And you can do that this morning. Just a reminder that next Sunday, April 7th, the Diocese of Springfield will hold two abuse crisis healing prayer services simultaneously at 2 p.m., both at St. Michael's Cathedral here in Springfield and at St. Joseph's Church in Pittsfield. They are part of the ongoing diocesan response to the abuse crisis, and all are encouraged to take part in at least one of these two services as a way to show their prayerful support to our abuse victims, survivors, and members of their families. And again, that's next Sunday, April the 7th, starting at 2 p.m. And asking all in our viewing community to join us again next Sunday at the same time, right here on the Chalice of Salvation, your spiritual connection. Next week, we will welcome Father William Wallace and parish members from St. Peter, St. Casimir Parish community in Westfield. Until then, my friends, may our loving God bless all of you and those you hope close and dear. See you next Sunday. Love to all. Goodbye for now.